Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to all of you. It is a joy to see all of you here this morning. This is a day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. The best part about this day is I can finally see almost all of your smiles, and it is a joyful sight. It surely is. It's just good to hear your buzz and your conversation. I apologize for interrupting it, but we have gathered here to worship with the Lord's people. We're going to begin with Psalm 130. If you would, if you're able, would you please join me in standing? I'll read the leader's part. I ask you to join me in the people's part. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with you, that you may be worshiped. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, in the Lord's word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, with the Lord is plenteous redemption. And the Lord will redeem Israel from all its, and let's pray. Father God, as we gather to worship you this morning, we lift up the name of Jesus. We welcome your Holy Spirit here with us. So bless us as we worship you this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you remain standing for our opening hymn? There is a fountain filled with blood.
Thank you. hungry, we were thirsty, with nothing left to give for the shape we were in. Just when all hope seemed lost, love opened the door for us. He said, come to the table, come join the sinners.
Prayer concerns are printed in the insert of the bulletin this morning. I invite you to have it in front of you as we come to the time of intercessory prayer. We're going to take a moment of silent prayer. I'm not going to lift up special names this morning, but I am going to let you know that four gentlemen in our church have recently lost their spouses, and three of those gentlemen are in worship with us this morning. Please have a special prayer for them in your heart. Will you bow your heads with me as we look at the list and as we silently intercede for these on our prayer concerns list? Loving God, we pause this morning to remember that our life once what it was like,
a life without direction, a life motivated by the whim of the moment, a life filled with doubt, a life filled with fear about what the future holds. If we're honest with ourselves, we didn't have a clue. But then we heard your gospel and we responded to your power within. It was then that we discovered Christ, in us the hope of glory. Jesus, you forgave us and taught us to forgive. You taught us to think of others before we think of ourselves. You transformed us from death into life and gave us a new purpose to live for your kingdom goals. You taught us a life of prayer, a life of worship, a life of mission, and the life of purpose. And so here we are today with a hunger to go even deeper into the life of your Holy Spirit. Come now and fill us, call us, teach us, send us, use us, and bless us in your kingdom work. All this we pray in your name, the one who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you, Brenda, very much. Well, I want to pick up kind of where I left off last week, if you were with us. We looked at Jesus' power over sin, and specifically we looked at how Jesus called the disciple Matthew or Levi, the tax collector, to follow him and be one of his disciples. And we looked at how Jesus was invited to a dinner party at Matthew's house, and the Bible says a lot of disreputable characters came and joined them. And so if you were here, we set the table, if you will, of the folks who may or may not have been at that dinner party. And this morning, we want to set a different table. We've set the table a little bit differently. But it's the same table. It's the king's table. And we've all been invited to come and sit at this table. You know, the sacrament of Holy Communion is about brokenness. Jesus said, "Take, eat, this is my body broken for you." Then he took the cup, said, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out, spilled for many for the forgiveness of their sins." So it's about brokenness. And as United Methodists, we talk about sacraments. We have two, baptism and communion, right? We talk about sacraments being an outward, visible sign of the inward working of God's grace and God's Holy Spirit that Jesus instituted, he gave to us. So it's a way, it's a means by which we experience the grace of God. It's God's pledge to us of his grace. But the sacrament of Holy Communion, it's also, it's like a mirror, if you will. Because when we come to the Lord's table, when I come to the Lord's table, we're given an opportunity to examine ourselves in this mirror. And what I see in this mirror is my brokenness, my sin, my need for forgiveness. But you know, the frame, if you will, around that mirror is the grace of God, the amazing grace of God. And it's amazing how God can use our brokenness, God can use our pain for his glory and for our good. Paul says in Romans 8, we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, those who are called according to his purpose. And that's why the sacrament of Holy Communion, this Lord's table, is important to us, because when we come to it honestly, when we come to it openly, we see our pain, we see our brokenness in the pain and in the brokenness of Jesus Christ, but we also see, we also meet, we also experience the grace of God. And so this morning, I want to use the story of a man by the name of Mephibosheth to help us understand this. Now, I want you to turn to your neighbor and say the name Mephibosheth 5 times as fast as you can. I guess it, Mephibosheth, 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 Mephibosheth. We don't know too much about this story. It's not a real familiar story, but it's found in 2 Samuel chapter 9. And I think it's a story that will help us better understand and prepare as we come to this king's table, because it's about receiving God's grace. Now, Mephibosheth came from a remarkable family. He was born with a bright future, a promising future. His grandfather, Saul, was the first king of Israel. And if you know the story of Saul, he was a good-looking guy. He stood head and shoulders above everyone else. But Saul came to the throne about the time that Mephibosheth was born. And Mephibosheth's father was the son of Saul, a guy by the name of Jonathan. Jonathan was next to the throne. He was a great leader in his own right. Not only was he an excellent leader, but he was a good human being. He was a person of character, of strength. But most importantly, Jonathan, if you know, was best friends with David of Goliath fame. But Mephibosheth was born into privilege and power and position, and I venture to guess that when he was born, not just the entire royal palace, but the entire nation just oohed and awed when Mephibosheth was born. Whatever he did, was the gossip or the topic of community gossip. Everything in his life, like any royal child, was chronicled in the newspaper and in the tabloids. When most children learned to walk, their family and close friends marvel. When Mephibosheth took his first steps, the entire nation was proud and pleased. But in an instant, just suddenly, all that changed very violently. His father Jonathan and his grandfather Saul, they went off to battle to fight their arch enemies, the Philistines. And in that battle, the Israelites were deeply defeated. Not only was King Saul killed, Jonathan was killed, and all of Saul's sons were killed in this battle. And in an instant, the royal palace, which was this haven of safety and privilege and luxury, became the most dangerous place in the country. And so in terror and confusion of retreat, a faithful royal nurse grabbed up young Mephibosheth, who was only 5 years of age, and she ran for their lives. But in the process, the Bible says that Mephibosheth fell, and he was crippled, severely injured. If he'd have gotten proper medical attention, he might have been okay. It might have been less devastating, but under the circumstances of escape and fear and terror, the nurse couldn't seek out proper assistance, and so as a result, the young boy Mephibosheth was permanently lame in both feet. He was crippled for life. And in an instant, a boy who would be prince, king, became a refugee. A young boy who possessed the natural abilities to leap and run and play was physically crippled for life. Meanwhile, King David, the warrior David, came to power, established himself on the throne of Israel, brought Israel to a prominence amongst all the nations, which had previously never had. And then one day, David makes an inquiry. He says, "Is there still anyone left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" He remembered his friend Jonathan and wanted to show kindness, because they were close friends. And David hoped that he could honor that friendship by showing kindness to some lost descendant of Jonathan. And he learned that Mephibosheth, Jonathan's son, was in hiding. He was still alive. And when the young man was brought before David, he came fearfully. So imagine, right? In ancient times, you know, if you were a family member of a previous king and a new king sought you out, you would think it was to destroy, right, any remnants of the previous realm. But David said, "Do not be afraid, for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore you all the land of your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table, always." And so Mephibosheth moved out of exile back into the property of his family. He was provided servants. And the scripture ends, the story in 2 Samuel 9 ends with Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem, for he always ate at the king's table, and he was lame in both feet. But the story doesn't end there. There's sort of another chapter. It happens about 20 years later when David's own son, Absalom, rebels against the throne, divides the country. David actually has to flee the royal palace for his own safety. And those who were loyal to David fled with him. Those who weren't remained behind, allied to Absalom. And one of Mephibosheth's servants joined David. But when David asked about Mephibosheth, the servant said that, he stayed behind in Jerusalem, thinking that he might regain his family's throne. And so the servant's story was plausible. David believed it. He promised that he would do everything in his power when he returned to the throne, David, that he would give Mephibosheth's property to this servant. But when David finally returned to Jerusalem, Mephibosheth came out to meet him. And the Bible said that he hadn't trimmed his beard or trimmed his hair, nor washed his clothes from the day that David had left until his return. And he insisted, contrary to his servant's report, that he had been faithful and loyal to David. And David wasn't sure what to do, And so with the conflicting reports, David said, you know what, well, I'll divide the property. Mephibosheth, you can have half, your servant gets the other half. And I share this story with you, friends, because Mephibosheth's story, I think, is a bit of a parable about this king's table, this Lord's table. Mephibosheth was born well, he was the child of a king, but he suffered a fall. He was lame. He was broken. And his story is sort of a parable for all of us. The Bible says when we were created, the heavens sang, the whole creation rejoiced. We were the icing of God's on the cake of God's creation. The psalmist says that we are crowned with glory and honor. We are made in the image of God. We receive the breath of God. What better start? What more promising start could we have had living in Eden in perfect relationship with God, with each other, filled with the very breath of God? But like Mephibosheth, we too suffered a fall. And that's a strange story. And it doesn't take much effort to discover that every one of us is born with this bent towards rebellion against God, disobedience. All of us find ourselves burdened with this inheritance of our first parents. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The blood of Adam and Eve courses through our veins. And we struggle with this condition every day. Now, Mephibosheth wasn't responsible entirely for his disability. The accident happened when he was so young, he could hardly do anything about it. It couldn't be prevented. He was, as some say, a victim of circumstance. And aren't we all? I mean, if we all think long enough and hard enough, we can find excuses for our sins. We can feel sorry for others as we do for Mephibosheth. But if there's any reasonable, measurable logic in what we call the amazing grace of God, it lies in the fact that our condition was not our fault, but it's our responsibility. But we must also say that, like Mephibosheth, what we do with our condition is indeed our responsibility. We are part of a fallen race, but it's our responsibility, our response to this condition, that makes all the difference in the world. We are exiles. We are refugees from God. We are separated by our sin. The preacher tells us we're made in the image of God, but sometimes I don't feel like it. And then one day we hear the good news of God's saving, forgiving grace in Jesus Christ. For Mephibosheth, it came that day when David said, "Is there anyone left in the household of Jonathan that I can show kindness to?" And Mephibosheth was called by the king, not on the basis of his own merit, but simply because the king was generous. The king wanted to show kindness. And when Mephibosheth came into the palace of his king, when he was invited, he stumbled in on crippled feet. You know, the biblical accounts are often brief in words and short and to the point. But three times in this short story, 2 Samuel 9, 1 through 13, three times in this simple story, we are told that Mephibosheth was crippled in both feet. Does it mention his age? Does it mention his name, any other circumstances? It simply says he was crippled in both his feet. When the story ends, it ends with he was lame in both his feet. And in biblical times, physical appearance and physical power meant everything. Hands represented skill, legs represented strength and swiftness of foot, and the feet and the legs were symbols of spiritual strength. And friends, I don't know about you, but I come to God as Mephibosheth came to King David. And I'm especially thankful for that verse, he always ate at the king's table, but he was lame in both feet. We come as exiles, as refugees, separated, but now accepted at our king's table. And sometimes when the prodigal returns home, it's not a pretty sight. And some folks are offended that they must approach God through the route of confession and repentance. But friends, how else would you come to the King of the universe except by confession and repentance? But here's the thing, friends. At the king's table, Mephibosheth's helplessness is hidden. It's out of sight. His disability does not frustrate him. The tragedy of his brokenness is in the past. It's out of sight. Here at the king's table, he is able, he is accepted, and he is adequate. And so it is with you and me when we come to our king's table. The tragedy of our human sinfulness is covered by this table. Our sins and transgressions are forgiven, never to be remembered anymore. We eat like sons and daughters of a king. Why? Because we put our faith and our trust and our belief in what Christ has done for us, in his broken and bleeding body. But you know, like Mephibosheth, after 20 years of eating at the king's table and enjoying all that luxury, there was a shadow that came over his life. When Absalom rebelled against David, it was said that Mephibosheth was a traitor, a terrible offense. And the Bible never settles the case. All we know, is that the king accepted him back. Received him back into his household and his family. And most of us understand that part of the story, don't we? Even though we were accepted to the king's table, sometimes we've been a little wavering. Sometimes we've been a little unfaithful, undependable. But always, unfailingly, the king invites us back. In grace and in kindness. A grace that's greater than our sin. A kindness that's greater than our inconsistencies. And it's a steadfast love even in our vacillations. And so, friends, we come to our King's table, our Lord's table, hobbled. Maybe not as pretty on the inside as we'd like to be, but at this magnificent table, our brokenness, our helplessness, our pain is hidden and it is healed. We come as members of God's family. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for grace that's greater than our sin. Grace that heals our brokenness, that hides our shame, and forgives us of our sin. So, Lord, may we come humbly, may we come gratefully for all you've done for us. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, let me give a little instruction. Some of you are familiar with these little individual communion cups, some of you aren't, but in just a moment, I'm gonna invite you to come. If you could start at the back, folks in the back, just when I ask, just make your way up and just sort of expeditiously, if you could come up the center aisle and make your way back to your seat through the outer aisles. But in each of these individual cups, on the bottom of them, you'll see they're shaped a little bit like a chalice. On the base of the chalice, there's a small gluten-free cracker. And then the top, there's a tab you can pull off. There's an individual serving of juice. And so what I would like to do, Brenda's going to come. She's going to play some music. And if you would like to partake, everyone is welcome. You don't have to, but if you'd like to, if you could just sort of file up the center aisle as expeditiously as you can, grab a communion cup, return to your seat, and once everybody's returned, I'll walk us through the communion part of our service. So would you please come at this time as Brenda plays? If anyone needs, that wasn't able to come forward, we can bring a cup to you. Is there anyone? No? Brenda, did you receive yours? You got yours? Okay. Friends, remember how on the night when Jesus was betrayed by one of his own, after the meal, the Bible says Jesus took the loaf, and after he gave thanks, he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you, for your pain and your brokenness, broken for you." So at this time, I invite you to pull the tab off for the small cracker and receive the body of Christ, broken for you. And again, after the meal, he took the cup, he gave thanks, and he gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take, drink, this is my blood poured out, spilled for you, for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. So if you'd pull the tab off the juice and receive the blood of Christ. Will you pray with me? Father God, we thank you. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for all the numerous, the many ways, the myriad ways that you pour out your grace upon us, how we experience your grace. But Lord, there is none like this. There is no other way that we experience your grace than when we remember what you have done for us through your Son, Jesus. Lord, fill us with your grace. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, that in spite of our pain, our brokenness, Lord, we may go from this place healed in spirit, refreshed, renewed in spirit, to serve you, to be your disciples and your witnesses. For we pray this all in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. During our closing song, a couple of them are going to come up the aisle with some waste baskets if you'd like to drop your empty cups. But if you are able, if you'd like, would you please stand as we sing our closing hymn, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms. Those were wonderful words. Just didn't happen to be the right words. But they were wonderful words, weren't they? Hey, friends, nothing can take away from the joy that we experience through the grace of God. So friends, hope this service was a blessing for you. Go out and enjoy this beautiful, worshipful Sabbath Sunday. Go in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen.